that we would apply it to our lives, that we could use it and grow closer in our walk to you. Lord, we ask that you be with Neil this morning as he brings us our message. Lord, may you speak through him and use him as your vessel, the Lord, to inspire us today. We ask all these things, Lord, as we lift this prayer up to you in Christ's name.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming this morning. This morning I'm going to discuss something that I myself sometimes have a problem. I'm sure most of our country and most of the people around in the world have a little problem with this. And I want to sit back and read some scripture for you today. And we're going to talk about forgiven, and forgave. Each three of these words kind of like mean the same. Forgiveness is something that's in the process of doing. You're in the process of giving forgiveness to someone. To forgive is something that has not quite happened yet, because you're still there to do. I want to forgive. I have not quite done it yet, but it's in the process. And forgiven is done. When it's completely done, forgiven. So in some ways, these three words means the same but have different meanings in a way. And this morning I just want to try to clarify exactly what each one says the best that I can. In my life, I struggle with some of these words, to forgive, forgiveness, whatever. And I struggled here in the past with it, and I'll explain that to you a little bit later on it. But I want to sit back with us, is to help us come together and be able to have this forgiving heart that Jesus tells us we should have. But the beginning of it is that each one of these words here occurs, which is like forgiven, it occurs 53 times in 45 verses in the Bible. And the other one's about the same. If you look about 150 times in the Bible, it's always talking about forgiving. And in my opinion, this is what it's about. Forgiveness. Forgiveness that's what that happened on the cross. It's definitely, the Bible speaks a lot of it. In the Old and New Testament, it speaks very much on it. And I'm just going to share with you a couple of my favorite verses in the Bible here. You don't have to open up your Bible or whatever. I'm going to go with the Old and New Testament on this, because it talks about them in both ways. In Daniel 9:9, to the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him. In Acts 5:31, him God has exalted to his right hand to be friends and Savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Therefore, let it be known to you in Acts 13:38, brethren, that through this man is preached to you forgiveness of sins. In Acts 26:18, to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. That's one of my favorite. Then we go to forgiven. Blessed in Psalm 32:1. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Ephesians 1-7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. These right here, it's just a few that talks about forgiveness, and to be forgiven, of course. But here in our world, that I find out, is mostly unforgiveness. And we live in a society today that everybody is at each other's throats almost. And that's with society in itself, and also individually. Families. What is unforgiveness? What makes that inside us that we that we're unforgivable? And I'm just going to sit back and talk a few reasons why resentment. You might resent somebody or somebody. Bitterness. Bitterness is probably a great big one. You know, you're bitter towards something that happened. Grudges. You hold a grudge against someone. He sat there and he did something to my lawn, or he threw this, or you have a grudge against someone. And someone can hurt your feelings. Now that really gets close to me, a family member or a good friend or something like that, that said something, did something, or whatever, that hurts your feelings. You can keep that there. Jealousy. Oh, that's a big one. You know, envy, jealousy kind of goes in together. You know, your neighbor's got brand new Cadillac, I'm jealous. I mean, he's this and this, whatever. Or it could be anything. You can be jealous against a coworker, your spouse, et cetera, et cetera. And anger. I mean, just downright anger. And that's the worst, is being angry. And all these, and there's more, come to where it prevents us to forgive each other. My mother died a couple years ago. And this is still fresh in my mind. She died a couple years ago. She died of cancer. You know, she had cancer. But as growing up, it wasn't cancer that really killed my mom. It wasn't cancer that was eating inside her. It was bitterness, grudges, anger, resentment. Those words right there makes my mother. And all growing up, she had it, and it made her angry. Oh, angry. I mean, it was mostly about family members. Somewhere a family member hurt her sister, mother, father. Excuse me. And she was angry. And she was angry all the way up to the day she died. And I've always sat there and tried to talk to my mom. Mom, you've got to forgive. Oh, I forgive, but I'm never going to forget. No, she did forgive. Don't get me wrong, you're never going to forget if somebody harmed you. It kind of sticks with you, but eventually it fades. Trust me, it does. But no, she held this stuff into her heart. And it's like, there's a verse here. If you forgive other people when they sin, this is Matthew 6:14. If you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. My mother never forgave. I won't go on with everything. It breaks my heart. But we do have a problem with forgiveness in our young. I personally went through this for 3 years, and mostly it hurts with maybe a family member or a friend or something like that. I keep doing you wrong over and over and over again, and that's the hardest thing to forgive when you have someone that's repeatedly saying something, doing something against you. Family or friends or whatever. I share some of this book. I've shared a little bit, if y'all know, but some of you don't. Is my stepdaughter, my wife's daughter, Sonia, which we all prayed for her. She was in a hospital. Quite good for life on that part. But for the last 3 years, she has really hurt our family and hurt me. She had a drug problem. Don't get me wrong, it's part of the story. But she did a lot of things that would hurt us. And, it was like one of the points where I was helping her out as much as I can, I help her, whatever, and she seemed like she turned around and stabbed me in the back. And I'd have to turn around. And okay, I would get angry, mostly hurt. Hurt was really what it was. But I had to forgive again.
Now remember,
Paul is, not Paul, but Peter's asking, he's asking Jesus, how many times do we have to forgive our brother? And Jesus goes, 7 times 70. If you do the math, you know what that is? 490 times. Now, I'll tell you something. My stepdaughter came real close. Maybe 398. I'm not sure. Oh, very close. But each and every time, I forgave her. And that was hard. The whole 3 years, I fought for this. You know what I mean? Like, I wanted to kick her out, take her out of my life, just shove her off to the, you know what I mean? I did so many times. I had so many different mixed feelings. And it really played on me for a while. I remember when Jesus says, 7 times 70. 400. I said, I got a long ways to go. So as a forgiving heart, I just continued forgiving her and forgiving her and forgiving and loving her. That's the most important thing that we need to do, is when we forgive, we must love and show love. And by doing that, it took a while, but slowly coming to, you know, she's clean, she's, you know what I mean, she's got her own place, I mean, she's fought for her life and all that, but she's slowly coming, and she accepted the Lord, you know, she's, you know, more and more get closer to the Lord. So, that forgiveness had a beautiful ending. Not, it hasn't ended yet, but it's a beautiful process of results to where she's coming about. Our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, when it comes to forgiveness, I can't say no more of how powerful His forgiveness was. How I myself want to live like Him to be able to forgive. And I don't think I'm never going to be able to stand up to what Jesus Christ has done for us. I mean, there's no way. You step back and you think about this. And this is something that plays in my mind, because I'm really, you know what I mean? Just telling you some of the stuff that plays through my mind. just take a person. Person gets betrayed. Gets betrayed by one of his closest people that was with his group, which is Judas. Betrayed. And of course, 30 pieces of silver had him arrested. They arrest him, put a hood over his head, they beat him, smack him in the head, mock him. Say, who's pops? You're the Son of God, you know who hit you. You know what I mean? It's all the things that sit back and that happened to Jesus, that, but he just stood there. They took him in front of a kangaroo, what I call a kangaroo court. Falsely, I mean, these people were falsely accusing him of stuff that was not true. But he stood there. Could I do that? I don't know. He's a mom type person. I like to defend myself about getting falsely accused. We did. They took him in front of Pilate, and they wanted, all they said to him, crucify. All they wanted was him to be crucified. To be crucified. Jesus continued to not say one word. He said a few things to Pilate. One thing he said, I am the truth. That is true. But he did. Then they sit there. All right, they flog you. Send them to be flogged. When they beat you back in those days, I did research on this. The whip had little bitty rocks, glass, you know, and sometimes seashell with jagged edges. So when they flogged you, it literally flew the skin. It just literally just made the skin like jello. Then he put a crown of thorns on the chest. Now he didn't have to go through this. This is what's amazing to me. He didn't have to do this. You know, he's a creator. That's what's amazing. He didn't have to. But they put a crown of thorns on his head, and they mocked him and said, "Hail, the King of the Jews," and put a purple robe around him, just mocking him, making fun of him. Then he took him off to a hill outside of Jerusalem called Calvary. And they laid him out and put nails in his arms, nails in his feet. Now, can you imagine that pain? I can't. I mean, if I get a toothache, I'm crying. I can't imagine the pain that Jesus went through. And I'm going to share something here with you in Psalm 22. Bear with me so I can find exactly where I want to be. I want to start on Psalm 22:11. This is before Jesus was crucified, but give you an example of exactly how he felt. If you want to go to Psalm 22, if you have a Bible, Karen, I'm in the King James. But this part is right here in Psalm 22. Really, I sit there and I really study this part to imagine what it felt like being on that cross, hanging there. Let's start at verse 11 here. "Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help." Imagine on this cross, hanging. "Many bulls have encompassed me, strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravaging and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint." Every one of his bones was completely, shoulders, legs, arms, out of joint. "My heart was like wax. Is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have encompassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me." So his head's down, his bones, feet are up, and you see all of his bones. "They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. But be not thou far from me, O Lord, my strength. Hasten me to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns." I'll stop there. That's how he felt, hanging on that cross. Just hanging, that's how he felt. Now I can't imagine the pain and the suffering that Lord the Savior went through. But here he's hanging there too, and there's people out there mocking him. He's between two thieves, and two criminals. One's mocking him, the other one's not. But they're mocking. As he's on the cross, they're continuing to mock him. So you went through all this. So when people tell me, "Neil, I just cannot forgive." When people tell me, "That person's hurt me too much. That person's hurt my family too much. Or this has happened, or that happened. I cannot forgive." I sit back and I come back and I say, "Oh, yes, you can. Yes, you can. First, you got to put Jesus in your heart." Because he standing there, hung on that cross, nailed to that cross. And what did he say? "Father, forgive them, for they know not what." Could I do that? Probably. I'd be. I'd But he did. Right then and there, he sat back and said, Father, forgive them. And such pain, excruciating pain, and sorrow and hurt. But he had a heart of forgiveness, of love, because you have to love to be able to forgive. Ephesians 4:32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another. This is what Paul says. Just as God in Christ forgave you. God in Christ forgave us. For us to forgive another, we must have Christ inside of our heart. I'm going to have Harvey play a couple songs as I close this. That when I myself, and I've played this probably so many times, it's unbelievable. Just listen to the words. When I myself get to where the world's getting at me and I start not having this unforgiving heart where I can't love and forget, I these two songs, which I have that unforgiving heart through Christ, but these songs help me out. Just the words. Just listen to the words. And then we'll close from there. This song, what you're going to hear here, from a CD called, I had to mention this, from a CD called Rejoice Africa. And these people, this choir, have been repressed through Africa. And they know what it's like when it comes to persecution. But they can sing such a beautiful song. The first one is called Lord, Let Us Be Your Instruments of Peace.
let us allow the peace that you have already to come out and touch the world around you. Let us not walk around and say, what can I do? How can I do it? As a child of God, you have that peace.
Thank you. We praise your name. Lord, we ask you to give us your peace. Help us make us an instrument of your peace. But most of all, Lord, give us that forgiving heart so we can become an instrument of your peace. But Lord, we don't want to let the darkness in. We don't want to let Satan into our lives. Because you are the Prince of Peace. We just need to help us, Lord, be more like you. Forgiving, understanding, and let the mercy reign. We just thank you, Lord, for this day. We ask you to bless us in our ways. Let us be more like you in all of our steps that we do in each and every day. We pray this in your precious Son, Jesus Christ's name.